So here we have the brain of someone who's suffering from multiple sclerosis. And you'll notice that there are these bright spots that are kind of located throughout the brain, known as plaques. These plaques are also referred to as lesions. And a lesion is really just a piece of damaged tissue. Now note how these plaques are forming in different parts of the brain. So the really important thing to keep in mind is that different parts of the brain will be responsible for different functions. So some parts may be involved in vision, movement, touch, cognition, and even emotion. So you can get a dysfunction in each of these categories depending on where the lesion forms. So for example, if you have a lesion that forms in parts that are responsible for vision or for seeing, then you won't really be able to see as well. So as it turns out, visual symptoms are actually among the first symptoms that people usually experience in MS, so I'm going to be talking about those first. So I'm going to show you here a picture of the eye, right? And so at the back of the eye, you have this structure over here called the optic nerve. And the optic nerve really just carries all the visual information picked up from the eye to the rest of the brain. And as it turns out, it's actually a pretty common site for lesion formation. So let's say we have a lesion that, you know, maybe it forms around here. So if you get lesions in the optic nerve, then you can imagine that there will be a lot of problems with vision. Now, it's not as severe as total blindness, but in general, your vision is impaired. So let's say, you know, you go to the eye doctor, they're going to ask you to read off of a series of letters on a screen across the board. So your ability to read off of the smallest letters will be pretty badly impaired, right? So you won't really be able to see these letters as well anymore. In addition to that, colors also appear a little bit washed out. So let's say, you know, when you have normal healthy color vision, this is a you're looking at this green box and it looks like this, right? But if you have multiple sclerosis, the green box may actually look a little bit more washed out. So maybe something like this, right? It's not as clear or not as distinct, I should say. So, you know, in addition to, you know, this impaired vision and this washed out color vision, people will also just experience general pain. So whenever they move their eyes around, it kind of hurts a little bit. So those are some of the major visual symptoms that people feel when they get lesions in the optic nerve. But there are other parts of the brain where people may experience, where if you get lesions there, then people may experience other visual problems as well. So I kind of have this green nerve coming out, right, from somewhere, and it's innervating the muscles of the eye, right? So this nerve will be responsible for moving the eye around. Now, where does that nerve come from? It comes from a part of the brain known as the brainstem. And really, there are more nerves that come out, but this is just to simplify our understanding of it. Now, in the brainstem, you have these cell bodies, right? So these cell bodies are going to project their axons into these nerves, right? And then these nerves will ultimately innervate the muscles of the eye. And as it turns out, this is actually a pretty common site of lesion formation, this general area of the brainstem, or at least where the axons are in that region of the brainstem. So you can imagine that you'll get a lot of problems with moving your eye around. So if you ever look at the eyes of a person with MS, what you'll notice is that they look like they're vibrating a little bit. So sometimes, you know, they may have a vibration motion, you know, horizontally or even vertically as well. In addition to that, if you kind of show a yellow bar of light, maybe, it could be any image, but let's say we have a yellow bar of light. If you show this, they may report seeing kind of a second yellow bar of light right next to it. So they're experiencing this double vision effect. And the reason is because, well, their eyes aren't really moving in unison anymore. So because they're not moving in a coordinated fashion, the images that they receive, they're not really able to converge those images that they receive. So because of that, you kind of see this double vision. You see two of one object. So the brainstem isn't really just going to innervate the eye, right? It can innervate other parts of the body as well. So let me clear up some space here. And as it turns out, the brainstem also is going to innervate a part of the body simply known as your throat. So you have a whole bunch of muscles in your throat, and the muscles in your throat are going to be doing a whole bunch of different things. So some really important functions would just be, you know, like talking and swallowing food. So if you get lesions in the brainstem, maybe you have some lesions that form over here, right? Then you can have problems doing just that. You know, a lot of people with MS, they may stutter a little bit. They may not really talk as well as they used to. And they may also kind of have difficulty in swallowing their food. It becomes much more painful and much more difficult to do just that. So now I kind of want to show you symptoms that are associated with lesions in another part of the central nervous system. So let me actually just clear up a little bit of space here again. So now I'm kind of showing you the picture of a brain of someone who's kind of facing towards you. And down here we have a picture of the spinal cord, right? And this is really just a segment of that spinal cord. So the spinal cord is going to be responsible for connecting the brain with the rest of the body. So it kind of transmits information about both touch and motor control between the brain and the rest of the body. So let's say, you know, you have some kind of nerve fiber ending over here, right? And this nerve fiber ending is basically going to transmit the information about touch to the spinal cord. And then from the spinal cord, that information is just going to be taken up to the rest of the brain. So maybe, you know, you have some more nerves that go up from the spinal cord and then into the brain, right? And here it's just later processed. So of course this is a very simplified schematic, but in general, if you get lesions in this area, you know, maybe you get some kind of lesion over here or maybe one over here, then you can get a lot of problems with touch. So one pretty common symptom that people might feel is numbness. In addition to that, people may have the sensation of pins and needles kind of prickling into their skin. And this is really just the equivalent of, you know, your limbs falling asleep, and we typically call this paresthesia. And then finally, people may just experience, well, plain old pain. If they ever, you know, sometimes if you look down or you look forward, then the person may kind of feel the sensation of like an electric shock kind of moving down their spinal cord and then radiating into the rest of their limbs. So it's not just touch information that's transmitted between the body and the brain, it's also motor information. So motor information can, you know, it can move down from the brain into the spinal cord. And then from the spinal cord, that information can contact another set of nerves that'll innervate the muscles of your hand. And if you get lesions in these areas, you're going to get some problems with motor control. So for example, you know, a lot of people may experience paralysis. They may not be able to use their legs to move around, so that renders a lot of people incapable of walking. So they need to use wheelchairs and canes to move around. On the flip side of paralysis, they may experience spasticity. And in spasticity, their muscles are too stiff, they're too overactive. And because they're too stiff, they become very tense. It's as if, you know, the muscles are just constantly contracting for some reason. And because they're constantly contracting, this can lead to, you know, quite a bit of pain in those muscles. In addition to that, people may also experience problems with bladder and bowel controls. So they may, you know, maybe they're urinating too frequently, or maybe they're finding difficulty in urinating. Right? There's a problem in the control of the bladder, and there's also a problem with the control of the bowel movements, right? And then finally, people may experience sexual dysfunction. So oftentimes a lot of people have problems in initiating or maintaining arousal, right? They may also have problems in achieving an orgasm. So next, let's turn this brain around and let's talk a little bit more about some of the cognitive symptoms that people experience in MS. So now our brain is kind of looking to the right, and you'll see that I've kind of already shaded in a part of the brain, and this part of the brain is simply known as the frontal lobe. So what does the frontal lobe do? Well, it's responsible for cognition. So what are some cognitive behaviors? Well, there's attention, working memory, thinking, and decision making. So if you get lesions in the frontal lobe, then you can experience a lot of problems in all these cognitive functions. So for example, you know, a lot of people may experience problems with paying attention to things. They may also be a little bit more forgetful. They may have problems thinking about and understanding certain concepts, and subsequently their ability to kind of solve problems is pretty heavily impaired. And finally, they may also be a little bit indecisive as well.